Yeah, today is not tea. Today we've got peach cola. Because why not? We're in Japan, and Japan is full of weird drinks. Hey guys, what's up and welcome to another episode. I'm Ombarus and I really like talking about software engineering issues and problems. And this week I wanted to show you a little bit a fancy custom way I found of building my own lists in Godot for making my life a little bit easier in the game I'm developing right now. In Solo Rogue right now, I have a whole bunch of UIs that require some kind of lists. I have like the drop cargo list, I have the equip cargo list, I have the mount points list, I have the crafting list, and in the crafting windows I have a bunch of different lists for what you need to for crafting and what you are using for crafting. And all these lists are very similar, but they require very tiny adjustments in the code to make them work or in the way they are being displayed. And I've been going back and forth between my own custom implementation of the list view and the Godot built-in item list node. And the reason for that is, for example, in my drop inventory window, I wanted to have checkbox next to each item, and this I couldn't find a way to do it with the item list node, so I had to come up with some kind of fancy way of doing lists using the scroll container in Godot. This was a very custom job, and when I went to try to reuse it in, for example, my crafting UI, then I realized that it didn't really fit and I had to do it all over again from scratch. And then in this one, since it wasn't anything fancy, I ended up using the item list, and then I came back to the custom list when I had to do like the drop inventory because it was very similar to the use inventory and all this kind of stuff. But I have this philosophy of software development now that the first time you encounter an issue, you should just make it any way you can, as fast as you can, and even if it requires statics and globals and whatever, just do it and get it there and make it work. And then the second time you see the same problem, you just repeat the same thing. You just copy and paste and you make it as ugly as possible. I mean, obviously not like the most ugly possible way, but try to get it working without thinking too much about it. The second time you can actually start thinking about it, but don't try too hard to come up with like the perfect solution for the generic item list thing. And then that's what I did in my game. I implemented a couple of times the different lists, but I didn't go overboard on the design. It's the third time, and by third time I mean it's not a hard limit, it could be the fourth or fifth time, but really around that time, if you have to do the same thing again, now it's time to start thinking about it. And the reason for that is that with the previous two times, you get some experience. Now you know how it works, and you know the limitation, and you know what kind of trouble you're gonna run into. And the third time, well, you have a good refactoring ahead of you. I mean, you know you're gonna be able to test it on at least three different places, so you know if your solution works for everything or not. If you try to do it on the first time, and then the second time you're gonna come in and you're gonna be like, shit, I didn't think about this, and now I have to review my whole structure, or I have to patch stuff in. But if you're doing it on the third time, yes, you have more refactoring to do from the first two times, but you're pretty much guaranteed to have thought of 90% of the issues that can come up with your solution. And I think that's a good way of approaching structure in general in your code. So that's what I did with the item list this week. I had a new UI to implement and I wanted to refactor my crafting. I wanted to be able to create any kind of row I want with texture, buttons, or checkbox, or icons, or I wanted to be able to change the color of each line. And to do that, I really needed each row to be like a separate entity that I could customize any way I want. As I got more familiar with Godot interface and the subscenes and the way to instantiate stuff, I came up with this little trick that I thought would work pretty well, and I spent a part of this week implementing that, and I'm going to show you how I did it. So the first thing I want to show you is kind of the structure I came up with, and for this I'm going to use some kind of nearly UML kind of diagram. I don't care that much about the actual way I design my UML. It's really just to give a visual idea of how I design my code and how I'm going to organize it. So the idea is that in blue you have stuff that comes from Godot, and this is what I was planning to implement. And so the idea is that my list is going to be inheriting from the scroll container from Godot, and it's going to have a set content and a get content. And these are going to be passing and returning arrays of JSON data. And then you have this row scene, which is going to be a prefab that's exposed. So when you instantiate this scene in your main scene, you can specify what the row is that you want. And then you can create, for every custom list you want to make, you create another scene that's going to inherit from base row. And the base row is basically just a control that will be added to the scroll container from my custom list. The base row has a couple of methods that you can or not re-implement, but the base system works for nearly anything. If you need to add, for example, a button and you want to add some custom code for handling the button in your row, then you can do that in the subclass of the base row. But the base row will by default handle all the metadata, the drag and drop, and all this kind of stuff, which makes it very easy to add a new type of row while not having to redo the whole structure of your list. And for example, already I have like the craft list row and the cargo row and the mount row, and I'm planning to add a couple of different ones. And what is nice is that now I just need to set the content with some JSON that is going to be customized for the type of content I want to display. So for example, the mount is going to have an index and the mount name, and then the code in here is going to be responsible for transforming that into something displayable, but without me having to re-implement like the scroll list container and the control and all that. All of this is already placed and it's already resizable. It has a flow and everything all set up properly. So if we go a little bit into the code, so here I have all the important scenes open. So the first one is the item list. Like you saw in the UML, the pack scene here is a reference to whatever rows I want to instantiate, and I can change it. I can go into my scenes and I can choose the item list, and I can choose like a default row or a craft row or something like that. For now, by default, it's the default rows. But for example, in my converter, I created these two lists, and they use a different craft need row. And the craft need row, the big difference is the way it handles the code here, and also the fact that it's a button instead of just being a regular control. And the other stuff is I added this string here that's a drag and drop ID, so that when I'm doing drag and drop, I can know if these two lists are compatible and if they can be dragged and dropped in between each other. So for example, in my converter, these two lists here have the same craft ID so that I can drop things between each other. And using a string ID like that, it means that all the drag and drop, or nearly all the drag and drop, can be just handled by the default list without having to inherit anything. Then the other part is the actual content. So I have this content here with a setter and a getter. And when you set it, for example, I have this debug here so that you can test stuff. So if the debug is at true in the ready, you can see I'm just setting some content. So I basically just call set content, and like I was saying, I just need to pass it some JSON, and the JSON just needs to be formatted in a way that the row I instantiate is going to understand. So the default row just takes a text attribute. It's going to set the rich text label to whatever text you put in the metadata. So when the set content is called, it's going to go over each row in the JSON data, and then it's going to instantiate an instance of this row, attach it to the scroll list container with the vbox container, and it's going to set the properties of the metadata. That's mostly so that it can handle the drag and drop automatically. And here it just sets the row data, and of course in my default rows I have another setter getter, so that when the row data is set, it's gonna save it in the metadata private attribute, kind of private, and then it's gonna set the rich text label. That's for the default. Of course, the idea is that I just need to override these two methods in any new rows I want to make. For example, in my craft need row, it's a little bit more complicated, but I don't need to implement all the other stuff. For example, in the default row, I'm implementing the drag and drop and the get drop data and so on. But I don't need to implement all that. I just need to implement the set row. Actually, I don't even need to implement the get row because the get row is just returning the metadata and it works fine for my stuff. If I had the checkbox or something, maybe I would want to re-implement my get row data to add information about whether or not the checkbox is checked or something like that. But in my case, for the craft need row, I don't need that. I just need to parse the metadata a little bit differently. So, for example, for the craft need row, the data I pass to the row is a little bit more complicated. I pass the color, I pass the source of the information I want to display, and I pass stuff like the count, and the missing true or false will change the beginning of the text. So basically, all the formatting is decided in this row based on the data I'm passing here, which makes it really nice because, like I said, it means that, for example, this content here, right? If I'm running a test on it, for example, right now I have hello world because that's what I set here. But imagine this is in the main source of my game. I can just easily do like something like this and write anything I want. I'm just gonna have my new row added here, and it's very, very simple. And since, like I said, in my game I'm using mostly JSON, it means that often I don't even have to transform my data any way I need to. I just pass directly whatever attribute I want to display, and poof, the row is gonna be displayed the way I want. So the best example in my crafting, like I was saying, I have these two lists now, here and here. For example, if I click on something like this, it says, okay, you have a skull relic, and I can drag and drop between these two. But for example, if I'm missing something, then it'll automatically change it to red and write it as missing, which is much more fancy than whatever I could do with an item list. This here is still a normal item list, but I'm planning to change it into the same kind of thing so that I can do fancy stuff with it any way I want. I think that's a really nice trick to pull off with all the Godot subscene slash prefab thing. And I think it's a nice way to use JSON as a kind of data structure. And that's why it's become more popular than, for example, XML, because XML is much more difficult to parse for a machine. But JSON is just basically translated as a custom structure that you can build on the fly. You know, I come from a C++ background, and if I had to implement that in C++, probably what I would have done is like have a base struct that would have been linked to my rows, but then each row would have had a pointer to the specific row that inherits from the base row struct, and then it would have used the data like that. And really the only difference between this in C++ and the way I did it in Godot is that it's much easier to implement in Godot because I can just do curly braces and brackets and write whatever I want on the fly, and I can change it without having to go and mess around in the hierarchy of structure in my C++. The disadvantage to that, of course, is that it's kind of hard to know what's the data that my row need. That's why I put a comment at the beginning of my GDiscript script, because I want to remember what it is that I need to specify without having to read all the code. But I think that's a minor problem, because anyway, I can read the code to figure out what I need to pass, or I can look at other example if this is reused somewhere. So I think all in all, it's just the flexibility it provides is just so much better. And this way now I can probably slowly port all my lists in my game to this custom list, and I'll be able to change the visual, make it any way I want, have buttons, drag and drop, and all of this kind of stuff. And it'll take me basically a few minutes to implement a new row type this way. All I need to do is create a new scene, inherit the GDiscript script from the base row, and then that's it, we're done. I hope you like my design. If you have some comments about it, just let me know in the comment section of this YouTube video. And I hope you hit that subscribe button, and see you guys in my next episode. Bye!